tracks are devising and driving channel marketing strategies. He has over 20 years of experience in multiple roles across IT hardware and software marketing, working for organizations such as IBM and Canon and Xerox. Prior to this role, he was managing the country channels for IBM India and South Asia for the Lotus brand. As a channel leader, his role is to ensure the channel readiness and effectiveness. And my own personal interaction has been with when I was working on the strategies and tactics of going to business market expos. While writing that paper, I got in touch with him and he did spend a lot of time explaining what happens over there. So he is a regular speaker at seminars and conferences, and especially focusing on business intelligence, SaaS, and cloud computing. So let us welcome Lux Rao, and for the next 1 hour session, we'll have close to 40 minutes followed by some questions and answers. He has a meeting to catch up, so we'll end up around 5 o'clock and have a tea and snacks and proceed. Well, thank you, Lux Rao. Thank you.
Ravi was telling me all of us here are actually engineers, right, basically.
Innova is an exabyte.
10 power 12.
I don't know, I'm not familiar with Zeros, but yeah. How many gigabytes?
1000 gigabytes.
No, that's terabytes.
That's terabytes.
1 billion gigabytes. Figure out the zeros now. 1 billion gigabytes. In 2010 alone, the amount of data that's been generated on the internet actually exceeds the total amount of data generated
pico,
for mankind.
Pico and then hexa.
Can you beat that? Last year alone, the amount of data that's been generated on the internet exceeds the entire data that's been available for mankind. That's actually, you know, the kind of, you know, comparison we are making. So we live in a world which is actually usually connected, data intensive and stuff like that. And the last part I'd like to talk about is actually about related to, you know, something which is actually of interest for all of us. Four out of the top 10 jobs in the current market today did not even exist in 2004. You can imagine, SEO specialist, for example, search engine optimization specialist, very highly paid job in marketing organizations. So these are some of the things that actually, you know, are the revolutions that are brought about by cloud computing. What I want to actually do to define the scope of today's discussion, it's a very vast subject, and when I was actually, you know, talking to Ravi and we were looking at, you know, what are the topics that we need to address in today's session, we felt that, you know, we actually address one element, which is actually the disruptive element of cloud computing. What does it mean to marketers? What is it disrupting? Are you all familiar with Who Moved My Cheese? Since you're all management students, you know Who Moved My Cheese, right? So actually, this is a scenario that can be related to the traditional IT vendor vis-a-vis the telcos or actually any of the new emerging distribution models that are there. I'll actually dwell upon that in a bit. And also, I'll take you through actually a real-life example of how something actually, you know, it's a nice term. See, analysts get paid top dollar for coining new terms, right? The term du jour today is actually called cloud service brokerage. Okay, Gartner actually came up with this term and the entire industry is milling around this term. And I'd like to actually, you know, demystify that for you, explain to you what a cloud service brokerage is, and then actually, you know, spend some time, you know, trying to understand where is the value addition in this entire layer coming in. Okay, so we can actually stop for questions. It's a small group over here. Let's make it as interactive as possible. If you're running short of time or something like that, I'll actually, you know, put a flag there. We can address it towards the end. So let's actually start off straight into the presentation. The reason why cloud computing is actually, you know, taken on a major revolutionary element is because it's actually power to the people. Today, I mean, it's actually, you know, really preaching to the choir to say something like, users are no longer constrained by what technology allowed them to do. Technology now follows what users want to do. This is really actually, you know, I mean, today, why is Twitter so popular? What makes you think actually that everybody would be interested in actually, you know, what you're doing every minute of the day or every hour of the day? It's just that the power of staying connected is actually huge power in the hands of the users. And that's the reason why actually, you know, this is becoming actually something that is changing the way people behave in their personal as well as their professional lives. We know Moore's Law, right? Actually, Moore's Law, which was applicable to transistors, has got a very ironical connection with cloud computing. Moore's Law actually talked about, you know, in very little layman terms, it talked about, although I can actually talk to you in technical terms, it's about, you know, the number of transistors doubling for actually, you know, every shrinkage in the printed circuit board. I mean, this was a revolution for electronics, right? Same thing is happening in cloud computing. If you're wanting a 1000x scale overnight, cloud computing makes that possible. Okay? How does it actually happen? Take for instance, actually, last week I was talking to a gentleman from Amazon, and he actually was presenting a case study. Today, if you actually want, let's say, you're running a company which is having about the computing power of, let's say, 5 computers. And you are actually, you know, doing something on the net and you expect a spiral because of a seasonal demand that might go up to 1000x. Sudden spurt in traffic, maybe a little bit on website kind of thing. So, within the season, for the 10 days, you actually, you know, have a huge spiral, maybe a zillion x actually at that time. How do you manage that kind of a load? Do you actually invest a lot in technology and keep it redundant all through the rest of the time only to cater to the seasonal load? Or do you actually, you know, have a way in which you elasticize the computing power that's needed? And that's actually where cloud computing comes up in a big way. What cloud computing does is, and you know, it's actually, you know, the power of click, as Amazon calls it. At the click of a mouse button, you'll be able to expand the elasticity of your processor to go up to whatever you want, 1000x, 5000x, 10000x, as much as the demand comes in. So if you're running a website and you don't know how it's going to scale up the demand, all that you do is actually go the cloud computing way. $20 per month per website, okay, for an e-commerce enabled website. You want to actually scale up, you know, to something like 100,000 1 month, it just becomes $40. And if you want to go to 1 million, it becomes $200. That's it. If you had to actually, you know, relate to an on-premise solution for that, you would have been set back by an investment of about, you know, something like about 250 servers, even before the first order was placed on your website. That's actually the power of cloud computing. And because of this huge utility computing value, there's a tremendous amount of draw on this technology. So what we actually covered today is the state of the cloud market. You probably would be actually aware of, you know, why the buzz around cloud. Introducing cloud service brokerages, I talked about the term. The changing paradigm, disruption is actually on the horizon, and how do we actually deal with it? How are companies dealing with it? It's a marketer's challenge today as it's coming up, and we would love to actually, you know, take on the challenge as we get back into mainstream shortly. And in the Q&A, we'll actually spend some time understanding some questions from you. Software as a service. See, cloud actually, you know, just to, you know, spend a, you know, a minute on cloud. Cloud is an umbrella term. It talks about, you know, cloud computing is umbrella. Under that, there are three clear pillars, and everybody in the industry have actually accepted this as a norm. Okay, there could be anything as a service, or X as a service as it's called, but there are three clear areas. You've got actually SaaS, which is software as a service, you've got PaaS, which is platform as a service, and you've got infrastructure, which is, you know, hardware, essentially computing as a service. So infrastructure as a service is the new hardware. PaaS is the new middleware, SaaS is the new software. You can relate to these terms actually as your today's computing. Okay? The market is actually very, very huge. You're talking about actually something like $9.2 billion in 2010, up 15.7% from 2009. It's actually defined the downturn in the economy, and so a lot of people believe that the momentum for SaaS actually came about because of the recession. Because pay-as-you-go is a model. Actually, do you want a little more details about SaaS, or do you all understand SaaS? Because I don't cover this actually under this topic, but if you want, I can actually give you some details about SaaS. You want some details about SaaS? Okay, what is SaaS? It's not a SaaS bubble serial. Okay, so it is basically software as a service. Essentially, SaaS is about, you know, using a software and paying for it on the go. Let me just give you a simple example. A 100-member company, okay? If they actually needed computing power in the past, what all do you think they needed? They would need. They would actually need a mailing solution, right? Essential. I mean, that's really the lifeline of today's business. They will actually need, you know, antivirus solutions for their hardware. They will actually need, you know, some stuff to run their core business applications and stuff like that, right? This is the software that is needed. To give you actually some benchmark or milestones over here, typical 100-member company at the rate of one computer per person, or even actually 0.8 per person, it will be about 80 computers with hardware. Okay, you'll need about 80 mailboxes. That's actually, you know, basically xyz@company.com. You know, you need 80 mailboxes. You will actually need, you know, some antivirus solutions and core apps. This is very plain vanilla fundamental requirement. You all agree with me on this, right? Now, actually, let's translate this into monetary terms. If I were to actually, you know, set up actually a mailing solution for this kind of a company, it will be actually before the first mail was sent out from the company, they will have to buy what is called as a server license. They have to buy what is called as a client access license. And all of that in the package, I mean, to cut a long story short, the entire package would be something like about 500,000 Indian rupees, even before the first mail was sent out, minus of hardware. Okay? How does actually this change? In a way actually, where, you know, the entire software is hosted by someone and you don't own this, okay? You access the way you access Gmail, but with a lot of security features built in, and that's how you're able to actually, you know, pay as you go. You're not investing in that server license. You're not investing in anything. All that you have is a browser. You've got an internet connection. Everybody has it. Internet is ubiquitous today for businesses. You actually access the service provider's site. You know, make use of the mailbox over there. And then do your work. And then actually, once you are done, you exit from there. That's it. Period. That's actually how, in simple terms, it works. What is the change? You don't have to invest a whole lot in these things. Typically, a mailbox today costs about, you know, a very high-end mailbox with calendaring and all of that costs about $5 today. Highest actually, you know, it might be $4 or $3 or whatever, but if you want actually really a fancy branded mailbox, like a Microsoft Exchange or something like that, you can give maximum of $5, and this is for 6 GB of data. So, what would it actually cost for simple mathematics? How much does it cost for 80 people? That's it. You put in $400, zero capex, no investment upfront, nothing at all, you're on. Okay? If you actually, you know, God willing, everything is going fine and you need to scale up to 1,000 people instantaneously, and India has been seeing such a lot of success stories, you know, where BPO scaled up from 100 people to 1,000 people actually almost overnight. How do you actually do that? You know, it's actually, you know, ask any CIO. Any of you here have been CIOs? IT managers? You've been an IT manager? You know how complicated it is actually, you know, if you have to do that. Call the vendor, negotiate, get licenses, put it in a server, I mean, in your own data center. The worst is actually going to be extremely complicated. So in the entire scenario, what's going to happen is, tomorrow if actually, you know, again for some reason it's right-sized and you have to bring it down to 200 people, what happens to all of that? Shelfware. Redundancy. The IT managers is being actually will be pulled up and say, why didn't you predict that? And stuff like that. Now all of these things are actually out with SaaS. SaaS offers actually three distinct advantages. Pay as you go. It's like actually, you know, eat whatever you want to and pay for whatever. That's it, you know. That's pay as you go. What? Second is actually scalability. From 100 to 1000 mailboxes is 24 hours. You just have to call the service provider and provision another 900 mailboxes. That's it. The third element is actually in terms of its no shelfware, or the ability to actually have zero capex, no shelfware, and any upgrade that happens centrally. You don't have versioning problems. IT managers actually struggled forever for versioning problems. Today I have 3.2, half of the people actually are on 3.2 and half of the people are on 4. How do you actually, you know, have, you know, intercommunication with all of these? This is a major problem. So SaaS actually offers these advantages. Now, what I will do is actually following this discussion, I'll actually, you know, do a quick synopsis and along with it, I'll attach a SaaS data sheet for you so you can circulate it for everyone. You can get more details about SaaS.
Okay. One of the concerns with SaaS was the proprietary data from the company goes and lands on the
website. Absolutely. Yeah.
So
yeah.
How does that get?
Good question. So I'll actually park this question for now. I'll address it towards the end because you'll come across all of these things, you know, increasingly as we go through the presentation. The security aspect of proprietary data or actually mission critical data, how does a SaaS vendor actually, you know, guarantee that? Or does he guarantee it all or not? This is a question that needs to be addressed, correct?
And in addition to this, can we also tackle the uptime? Is there any downtime that they...
Good questions. Very good questions, actually.
What is that they actually promise?
Yeah.
What kind of uptime? And you talked about $4. Is it like... only the first upfront call, there must be a recurring cost every month.
$4
per month per user.
For month per user.
Uptime is actually one of them. What is the other one?
Security.
Okay. Let's actually address this question separately. Okay, there's a recurring cost, of course. Yeah.
And can you also mention about latency? Do we have a latency when you have geographically distributed systems?
Latency?
Can go from 100 to 1000 in 24 hours, but if you want to go from 1000 to 2000, does SaaS makes a lot of sense because there's a break-in point for the
absolutely
having it in-house also.
Very good point. What is actually, you know, the tip-over point?
Yeah.
What stage makes sense for you to actually, till what stage can you go SaaS? That's a question, isn't
yeah
it? Okay, so what's actually the tipping point? Okay. Pardon my scroll. Okay. We'll park these questions and address it actually as the time comes up when we're talking about the ecosystem. So, but suffice it to say, there must be something good about the whole thing for the market to actually show such bullish growth. You're talking about actually a massive market opportunity, and this is in 2010, which means actually these are corroborated numbers. Okay? Stronger growth in 2011 with worldwide SaaS revenue totaling $10.7 billion, a 16.2% increase. It's actually, you know, tracking magnificently. So much so that even actually, you know, the big daddies of software, you know who they are, right? Microsoft, Steve Ballmer actually announced early last year, and I have no great love or love lost for him. He actually announced an all-in strategy for the cloud, which means every damn research and development around software is going to be related to cloud for Microsoft, period. They will actually milch the cash cows over there, which is Microsoft Office and all that, but new development is going to happen only around the cloud story. That's it. So if everybody is talking about cloud, there must be some success or secret sauce in there. Infrastructure as a service. This is actually, you know, market. I'll give you some SaaS players, okay, before we go ahead. You have heard the names. Salesforce.com is one. Microsoft is another. All of these companies actually are SaaS poster childs. But while actually I talk about all the marquee names, there are also actually a large number of organizations that are making a huge mark, you know. Indian companies, for instance, actually. You don't even have heard of companies like Viewfinder and all that. This Baroda-based ISV, actually with a coverage of about 40 customers prior to 2009, in the year 2010 was actually selling in half the globe, and his business actually scaled up something like about, you know, 500x just because of the cloud computing story. These are success stories. So any of you who got an idea, if you got a great killer idea, along with mobility, cloud is another way in which you can leverage the idea and see mega bugs actually happening to your business. Infrastructure as a service will increase at a CAGR of 52.53%. This is huge. And because this is real value, Amazon is actually one name that comes straight away to mind. Otherwise, you actually have companies like Eucalyptus and all that. But what's this space? You will actually have announcements coming in from Google and Microsoft and actually all of the big names for the infrastructure play very soon. US federal IT budget devoted to cloud computing spend will reach $1 billion by 2012. And this is actually now, here and now, right? Just today, actually, you know, the CIO of federal, okay, Vivek Sundra, has announced a cloud-first policy for federal. I mean, you can just check it out on Google today. You can actually, you know, see how every investment that's going in is actually through the cloud. What's the cloud service brokerage opportunity? Like I said, actually, analysts come up with fancy terms, right? Cloud service brokerage is one of them. The future of cloud computing will be permeated with the notion of brokers negotiating relationship between providers and clouds. Too much of English over there. Screw that. Forget it. What we are actually saying over here is that there is an emerging layer, a value-added layer that's actually coming in. Okay? I'll jump to the next slide and explain what is this value-added layer. I'll come back to this in a bit. You've got a service developer over here. These are actually the key players in the development of the software to the delivery to a consumer. Think of actually software as a Microsoft Office application. Microsoft developed the Office app, and then it actually, you know, passed it on to a distributor who actually picked up the software, priced it, packaged it, gave it to a sales guy, who then actually went and sold it to a reseller, who then took it to a customer, and then he realized some revenues out of it. This is actually the traditional distribution model. How does it actually pan in with respect to the new emerging trend here? Service creation happens with the service developer. A new service is created. Publishing of the service, analytics is actually understanding how the service is working and building in crashes, upgrades, and all that is happening with this. Service provider is the guy who is actually providing the infrastructure management, which is reporting SLAs, capacity, and all that. The guy who is actually, you know, having the service available in a common place, maybe a Google or maybe actually some, or a Microsoft themselves who actually have posted it in a data center. There are SaaS applications, there are platform applications, there are infrastructure applications, and a whole lot of things. Some names over here. Service actually is, you know, could be provided by one of the SaaS providers, could be Microsoft themselves. Infrastructure is actually provided by the likes of Amazon. Then the environment is actually provided by, you know, again, Amazon or Microsoft themselves. Then services management, which is security, disaster recovery, and given actually by companies like IBM and whatever, okay? And then there's a service consumer. This is the new value-added layer that's actually come up. Why? Okay.
Just a minute. Service broker, same as the integrator, the person who integrates it.
Okay.
Or is it different?
And the same integrator, okay, there is, I think you have a point over here. System integrator is actually someone who actually packaged the solution to the customer. Typically, a system integrator, a very large system integrator, someone like a Wipro or an Infosys, who actually identified the right solution actually for the customer, and then packaged the hardware, the software around it, and actually, you know, went and installed it at the customer's premise. Is it a system integrator? A system integrator can become a cloud service broker, but a cloud broker is not a system integrator. Okay, let me just define that. Just bear with me for a minute, we can ask questions. What does a service broker do? Why is it actually, you know, suddenly, you know, caught the fancy of Gartner's and actually they're talking about billions of dollars in revenues and stuff like that? Who is this cloud service broker? What's this new animal that's actually emerged in this entire paradigm? Actually, cloud service broker offers definite values. If you're going to actually consume a service from the cloud, okay, who is going to actually manage the SLAs and all that stuff? Would you buy from actually a non-entity or would you buy from a known name? Typically, actually, you know, you would buy from someone you know you can pay. You want to go for a branded name. How many of you saw the newspapers today in the morning that Tata has actually announced and made a cloud play? Have you noticed that? It's been all over the place. Yesterday morning was the launch, and the launch actually was such so large that even Mr. Ratan Tata himself actually made it for the launch.
Is it for the SME?
Actually, they will go to one cloud mall. They will go to one service provider who can give all the solutions actually under one roof. And that's really why you have the likes of, you know, Tata is actually, you know, getting into it in a big way. Okay? Yeah.
Second question is, if you can share some trends about in the Fortune 100 or Fortune 500.
How many organizations? I have some interesting statistics for that. I'll talk to you. I won't write it down. I'll talk to you in a bit on that. Some kind of question, yeah.
So, you mentioned IaaS, that is infrastructure as a service, right?
Yeah.
I thought Amazon is playing that role.
Yeah, it is playing.
It is, but you mentioned in the infrastructure management is typically where Amazon is.
Absolutely. They do this also, capacity management, as well as actually offer it as a productized commodity. If you want to actually host, if you want to lease computing space from Amazon, you can have it as a large company. If you want to actually pay by the hour to Amazon, you can pay at 10 cents an hour to Amazon. They have both offerings. You can have a captive database set up into Amazon or Savvis. Have heard of names like Netmagic, Savvis, and stuff like that. These are companies that have large, very large server farms. They've got hundreds of thousands of servers, and they actually offer the computing space on rent. So as a company, you must be, let's say, a 1,000-member company, or 1,000-user company, you will go and actually negotiate with them a contract for utilizing the space month on month, every month. You are actually running a company which is, you know, related to this model, and you have a seasonal demand. For 2 months, you need only computing space as a commodity. You go and actually buy it from Amazon. So Amazon actually, you know, will do both the things. And Amazon is just a name. You could actually have Rackspace, Savvis, Netmagic, Petrolis. There are plenty of names. The last two names that I mentioned are from India. Petrolis, Netmagic, these are Indian names.
So they have invested a lot in these server farms, right. And they don't know what to do, so they let it up.
No, there is actually a method to the whole approach also. It's not as if actually, you know, it is coming up as an alternate revenue mechanism. They have invested it only for this purpose, because they see how this market is actually going up in a big way. Tell me one thing, if you are running a business and you see 52% CAGR on a particular product trend or a technology trend, wouldn't you invest in it?
Sure, I think Amazon started that.
Amazon started that. Actually, Amazon leased the extra space. Then it became actually a trend. You're right. Question?
In the last slide, you showed that for the 2010, it was predicted to grow, the SaaS market was predicted to grow 15% to 9.2. So obviously, it was a older slide. So yeah. What is the exact figure for 2010? Is it actually $9.2 billion?
$9.2 billion. In fact, actually, that's the reason I said this number is corroborated, because 2010 is already over.
Yeah.
It's $9.2 billion actually. Yeah, it is actually $9.2 billion. And 2010 actually, you know, like companies like HP actually close in November. Some companies close actually, you know, in December. Some companies actually close in Jan. Mm-hmm. They have February Jan and stuff like that. So to get a holistic number, it will actually take some time. That's why I said it's corroborated as $9.2 billion actually. Okay, let's move on. So what is this new cloud service brokerage layer actually giving you? So one thing is that you want to buy from a known name. You can buy a great service, but you go to a mall for what reason? Because you have the assurance that it's actually a good quality service, right? So that's the reason why actually a cloud service broker also is gaining in popularity. The second advantage is actually something called a SLA monitoring. Okay, this also actually answers the question over there, which was relating to uptime. Now, a cloud service broker, okay, make sure that the vendors who are actually providing the cloud service will offer whatever is guaranteed on the SLA. Okay, because the vendor could be located actually anywhere, but you need to talk to these people who can actually, you know, bring in this thing. Who are typically cloud service brokers? Let's actually talk some names so that you can unravel this whole thing. One of the examples of a cloud service broker that you will see going ahead could be someone like Bharti, Airtel. Airtel carries the last mile to the customers, correct? Through their broadband, they carry the network. Now when they carry the network, they can actually stream in the services also through the same network and charge the customer for it on a monthly basis. And who better than a telecom provider to understand actually how an annuity return works, which is a monthly subscription works. Because their whole business model is based on annuity, right? They charge you every month for voice, 300 rupees per month for connectivity and all that. So a small business actually can get all the automation they want in 10,000 rupees a month. Everything. I'm just giving you actually a hypothetical number. It changes actually for organizations, but you can actually do that. So this layer of abstraction, the service broker, is actually, you know, the one through which, the gateway through which we actually have, you know, buyers buying it. And I'll show you a live example of this towards the end of this presentation. Okay, and there's also something called role-based access control, reporting and auditing, and single sign-on. How do you understand single sign-on?
Yes.
SSO? Yes. You understand, right? So if you buy five services, if you had five different passwords and five different logins and all that, crazy, isn't it? I mean, it actually can be pretty difficult to manage all of that. So single sign-on ensures that depending upon the role of the person who's accessing that particular portal, he or she will get access to all the services that they've purchased on one single sign-on. That's actually what a cloud service broker assures. It doesn't matter who is the maker of the service, but the provider of the service actually is ensuring role-based access, security, and stuff like that. Okay. What was the question that actually you asked?
Me?
Yeah.
There are two questions. One is the service broker and the integrator.
Yeah.
How companies like Infosys and Wipro.
That's right. So.
And the second was about the Fortune 100 and 500.
Yeah, I said I'll answer that question, right? Very interestingly, and you can actually answer the answer this question yourself, okay? Because the answer is in the question. Small and medium businesses actually have been very, very rapid adopters to this as compared to large organizations. Can you tell me the reason why?
It's not scale at which they operate. It's difficult for them to be able to, you know, build such scale overnight, as you said, and they're better off, you know, paying as per use.
Yeah.
So it makes sense for them to, you know,
so zero capex and stuff.
Is this an investment?
Yeah. In fact, that's how the doctors and the early doctors are not the large corporations.
Absolutely.
You're already onto something.
Yeah.
Whereas in a new business company, you know, still start up.
Yeah.
That's
a good
point.
That's
a
hitting
point what
we're
talking about.
Yeah.
Break even.
Also, very valid point. I think I've got all the answers actually. You were saying the scale at which they're actually operating.
Existing investments they've made.
Absolutely. Legacy is one of the biggest barriers to actually move to cloud. They've already invested billions of dollars, maybe millions of dollars actually into, you know, existing systems and solutions over there. They don't want to actually, you know, disrupt that and move to the cloud. But then enterprises are moving to the cloud. The thing is already happening. So if I do a dip test today and look at how many companies in the Fortune 100 are into the cloud, almost everybody is using cloud services, maybe a few services, but they have not moved en masse to the cloud. And there's one other reason actually, you know, why large enterprises are not moving to the cloud. This is related to security. There is an inherent worry that the data is actually outside their firewall. So there could be compromises with the data. So because of this, there's an emerging trend called the private cloud that's coming up. Private cloud leverages everything that the cloud as a solution offers, but makes it within the firewall. Okay? Better still, there's something called a hybrid cloud. Okay? Public cloud for actually all those non-mission critical applications, and a private cloud for sensitive data. So a large bank will actually have entire customer-related data behind a firewall, but they still make use of mailboxes and stuff like that from a public cloud, or a CRM from the public cloud.
It is private, how is it cloud?
It is cloud for a large entity, if there is actually a distributed setup. I mean, take the example of actually someone like HP, globally. They've got actually about 115 operating units, small, large offices across. HP BPO, HP and all of that stuff. So what actually happens over there? They are actually evolving this concept called a shared service model, where everything moves to the cloud, but it's within the enterprise level.
On the premise.
That
okay.
Probably is today also.
It's already happening. I'm actually only saying that, you know, have they got the ability? The difference that you have to understand is actually from the earlier they used to actually make use of that, but they were limited in the multi-tenancy of the product. A mailbox application, a Microsoft Exchange, would not actually operate unless you had a repeatability stuff for catering to 200,000 users. Today, because it's multi-tenanted, Microsoft themselves have actually come up with a solution that caters to multi-tenants, which is all the 200,000 apps centrally located from an office, which is actually, it could be in Beijing or it could be actually in Bangalore or in Singapore, catering globally. A 24/7 setup.
Effectively, you're saying is that the one thing you get is taken care of.
Absolutely.
The licensing issue stays for a simple reason that it is private.
Yeah, there is only the commercials will change.
The commercials will, the licensing issue stays, right?
You're moving from a yearly. See, I'll tell you what, there's something called shelfware. Today, actually, you know, you are predicting that the Bangalore office will actually grow to, let's say, 5,000 people. Correct? You didn't grow because the number of clients didn't come in. You would have, in a licensing model, you would have purchased 5,000 licenses in anticipation. In a cloud model, you actually go.
You can make it linear function, so to say.
Absolutely. Those are some of the. That's what I was saying. It's behind the firewall, but takes the advantages, which is both commercial and technological advantages of the cloud. And also, tomorrow when actually, you know, the migration to a hybrid cloud happens, it's easier.
I mean, honestly, I'm slightly skeptical of the fact that, you know, what they say is typically in an organization, the moment things, such an application of some becomes private, the willingness to, you know, go ahead, customize, modify to my needs, all these stories, you know, start playing.
Yeah.
Right? And all your productization, standardization goes for a loss.
Well, actually,
the whole story, if I understand it right, is spinning around, keeping it standard, keeping it common across all the
operators. That's a very, very important point that you raised. How standard is standard actually? Because you're expecting that all users will have the same kind of requirements in a cloud model. May not be. Maybe there are actually a set of services, like, you know, a mailbox could have a flavor of 2GB, 4GB or 6GB. Okay?
There is an extent to which
you can actually standardize. But then, when actually customization happens, and that's the reason why cloud is not all pervasive. As you move up the value chain and get into actually ERP and, you know, stuff which is actually related to specific workflows, cloud may not be the answer. Okay, it works on the classical pyramid structure. Highest propensity are those applications that are actually common for everyone and standardization is very competent. Thanks for bringing up this point, but it's a very valid point. It actually, you know, gets into a level of, you know, ubiquitous usage only for those apps which actually have commonality in usage across spectrums, across user groups.
So the moment you say mission critical applications are on private cloud, essentially I'm saying is I want to keep it private to the extent that data is not shared and I can tweak it the way I want.
Yeah, you can tweak it the way you want.
What happens, it's not standard.
Yeah, it is not specific to the enterprise. But then you could actually have a scenario where 80% of the apps consumed by an enterprise is actually public, 20% is private.
I think you talked about Fortune 100 moving towards cloud.
Yeah.
What would be more interesting is year on year the IT budgets.
Yeah.
What percentage of the IT budget is going into cloud applications?
Yeah.
And what percentage is still staying with the old standards?
We don't have a full year of study still. There's no body of work that actually points to that. The reason being, enterprises came out of recession. So this just started opening up their first things now. So IT budgets are still actually a little tight. Okay, maybe next year, you know, if you are connected actually on a group somewhere, I'll share that information with you in terms of how many Fortune 100 organizations had what share of the budget on the cloud. But suffice it to say, every single Fortune 100 company you can think of actually has got at least one cloud service each. Maybe a Salesforce.com, maybe a Mailbox. And even today, actually, you know, you're talking about, you know, Microsoft Exchange Mailboxes is a very, very big story where they're going from on-premise to on-demand. On-demand is cloud. And if they didn't move it, chances are that Google will actually come and take that. And that's the reason why there is a tremendous amount of movement of migration into the cloud for enterprises. So it's the, like I said, you know, the question, you will actually be asking this question many times during the session, which is who moved my keys? So this thing will actually happen. Okay, so very, very interesting points that you've actually brought about here. And this service broker layer, and you know, it gets this better in this ecosystem.
Go back to the diagram, just one small thing on the window. The network owners are nowhere in the structure because network owners will play a key role in delivering the service.
Yeah, I mean, I've not named anyone over here. This is actually your architecture. Look at this as an architecture. You'll have someone who's creating the service, someone who's hosting the service and managing the service, and someone consuming the service. There's some one layer, the value-added layer that I'm talking about, that abstract layer that will actually come in and, you know, manage all of these things. And that, I mean, you actually preempted my next slide, which is this. How does a cloud services ecosystem look like? What do we see over here? Wow, this is actually a bunch of very popular and not so popular services. Think of this as a catalog. You're all actually working in an organization, and the day you join, you're actually asked to pick and choose what services you want over here. Okay? Select that. Like I said, you've got small businesses, or medium businesses, or enterprises over here. It doesn't matter. These are the consumers of those services. How do I actually carry this service, any of these services, from here to here? Can you tell me the traditional distribution model? Anyone? I mean, you all know, right? How does the traditional distribution model work?
Vendor
seats,
heavy enterprise.
Yeah.
Working with so many vendors, so many SLAs, contractors.
Contracts and all that. That's enterprise story. How does it actually work for SME?
Number of seats, number of licenses that you
have. No, I know. I'm saying, you know, from point A to point B, from a service creator to the service consumer, what's the route?
Small business will be a reseller who will be, you know, creating a bouquet of these services and delivering.
Absolutely.
And doing all the customization.
Absolutely. Absolutely. There is actually a reseller for the service. You know, someone around the corner who actually, you know, keeps all of these stuff. Okay, maybe hardware, maybe some licenses and all that. ABC computers, Prism computers, you name it actually, you've got a bunch of these companies. At a very large level, these are the Wipros and, you know, all of this part, the large system integrator. Then you have got actually the medium-sized system integrators. Then you have the small resellers. And then you actually have the agents. The guys who actually, you know, do the running around, but they don't have the ability to implement it and all. So the food chain actually, you know, is very elaborate in a traditional distribution model. Let me walk you through this. Microsoft actually, you know, announces a product, passes it on to Ingram Micro, which is actually the distributor for the service. Micro Micro actually, you know, trains its people and then actually, you know, crushes it down to actually about 14,000 resellers in their ecosystem. The resellers actually, you know, take the training, go and actually sell it to, you know, hundreds of thousands of organizations, and that's how the typical food chain actually works. Okay, this is really the traditional distribution. This thing is about to change dramatically. This year is the inflection point, and there is a huge war out there. And that war will actually redefine how services are going to be consumed in the future. And this is actually real. This is for now. Okay, I'll leave this blue box here for a minute. I'll just come back here. Wow, you had the traditional resellers coming. They're already there. System integrators are already there. MSPs are managed service providers. You know, people who actually, you know, do everything on a per seat basis. They're also there. But look, wow, telcos. Wow. But since when did telcos meaning telecom companies, actually start selling Microsoft Exchange? That'll change actually dramatically very, very soon. I can say it for sure because we are actually one of the leading cloud providers. Wait for the announcements. Retail. Staples will start selling Microsoft Exchange boxes. Reliance will actually start selling Microsoft Exchange boxes. I'm talking about Reliance Retail. Banks. We've got a bank in Ireland which actually, you know, suggests to SMEs, small businesses, what is the set of technology tools they need to buy before they get a loan. When did they become IT savvy? And what about these guys? You know, they have been actually traditionally over there. They have been actually, you know, thinking that, you know, no one can come in and take over this thing. But this is all changed now. You are telcos, retail, BFSI, all actually making a beeline to this opportunity, the cloud opportunity. And why this is actually possible? Why can a telco think it's suddenly, you know, they're able to actually deliver this? Is because of what Jamcracker does in between. Jamcracker, this the organization that I work for, we've actually been in business for about 10 years. We've actually built the IP around how to make a service available on the net. That means, like a turning on, turning off. If you want electricity, what do? You go and switch on the light. When you switch on the light, you pay per consumption, right? It's a fundamental thing. If you use more, you pay more. If you use less, you pay less. Who is monitoring all of that usage? There's a company which is monitoring all of that usage, right? That is actually, you know, called provisioning. Okay, someone is tracking the usage of the service. Someone is doing the integration. A new service comes in, you put it on board over here into the catalog. Billing and settlement. Hundreds, thousands of organizations, someone is actually, you know, collecting the credit, money via credit card, checks, whatever, and then actually doing the settlement to the entire food chain. Security, user management. In terms of business enablement, go to market, training, and help desk support. So, Jamcracker offers that. So, you've got actually a company like Telstra, for example, in Australia. It picks up the whole thing, white labels it as Telstra, and sells it to the market. Jamcracker in the back end, and providing Microsoft or actually IBM or, you know, lesser popular services and stuff like that on a per monthly subscription model, and everything is actually made available to the end user. And then what have you got? Telstra actually, you know, raking in the revenues. We do the settlement, we manage the help desk support and all that. Telstra only focusing on sales and marketing. That's it. This is disruption. And just imagine now for a moment if Airtel does that in India, or Vodafone does that in India, or Reliance does that in India. Suddenly you have a disruption happening. And as we are talking, all the tier 1 telcos, when you say tier 1 is the number of subscribers that you have, anything over a million is loosely called as tier 1 telcos. Tier 1 telcos, system integrators, whether Wipros or Infosys, or distributors like Ingram Micro, Westcon, any of the distributors, everybody's talking to us because of this thing, simply because they need this layer. Now they can develop the layer. There are a large number of organizations that have actually said, you know, there's no rocket science into this. They can actually build this layer also. But it might set them back by about 8 to 9 quarters. That's actually about, you know, 2 years. So will they actually, you know, work with Jamcracker, or will they actually go and, you know, build their own platform? This is not a sales pitch and you're not buying this product. Don't think that I'm actually making a sales pitch out of it. But watch out for this cloud service brokerage model. This is going to hugely change the way in which things are going to work. Probably in 2012, you'll have ICICI, the SME portal, offering services which are actually things like, you know, exchange mailbox, antivirus solutions.
Why do you need to be one level up, one level behind, if I may say,
yeah,
in the whole chain?
Yeah.
Just because of the customer base.
The last mile.
Guys,
the last mile. and also because of our bandwidth. I don't have the bandwidth to expand to 160 countries and be present in front of customers. I'd rather actually work with those guys who actually have that bandwidth.
The guys who make the max out of this whole scheme of things will be the guys who are in the front end. So why be at one level?
I'll tell you how the breakdown happens. These guys actually, you know, will transfer a product to, let's say, $100. Okay? We keep actually, you know, $8. Just $8. The telco will actually keep about $30 and they pay about $15 or whatever it is actually to the reseller. That's it. That's how the dollars are going to break down. Exactly the same model, but there's no Ingram Micro here. Ingram Micro will actually be replaced by a telco player.
That's one part of the story.
Yeah.
I'm just saying, let's say just hypothetically assume the network is something that's available to you on lease for a minute.
Yeah.
That's assumed.
Yeah.
Like, would you not do that last mile yourself?
Yeah. Yeah.
Because the sheer economies of scope for the telco is much bigger than what they'll get as $15. Right?
Yeah.
But the stickiness of the customer will be huge in terms of this.
Yeah.
So they are probably, you know, in terms of the whole cycle,
yeah,
they are much better benefited instead of, you know,
absolutely. We'd rather than actually, you know, work along with all of those guys and work with the maximum amount of them rather than actually, you know, bring in the competitive threat to them by working in a smaller market and build the market and our brand equity. See, it's always actually going to be a toss-up between, you know, which way you want to approach, right? Your go-to-market actually will involve, you know, leasing the network, building your brand, making sure you actually have the customer sales reps and all that in. All of that actually, you know, is going to take a huge amount of investment. Why not work with those people who already know the game? That's really our approach. But nothing is preventing us. And by the way, actually, since you asked this question, we also run our own marketplace for Yammer. Just to actually settle the issue there.
One more question, Vince. Will not the system integrators tomorrow seeing this lucrative market?
Yeah.
Will be a competitor to Jamcracker. They can
system also integrators will own this and then become Jamcracker. See, the thing is actually it's co-opetition. Instead of competition, let me call it as co-opetition. So Infosys or a Wipro will work along with us and then actually partner us on deals rather than actually build this own platform themselves. But there are people who are building it, you know. For example, you know, HCL could be building their own platform. But the thing is, you know, it takes a lot of thrills and skills before they come up with actually a platform that is, you know, ready to deliver.
In fact, sorry, I'm just, you know, driving this point out too far, but if you have a competition,
yeah,
you have somebody stand, you know, standing beside you,
yeah,
as a you know, competitor in the second layer.
Yeah.
It's a co-opetition like an Infosys,
yeah,
they come between the channel,
yeah,
and you.
Yeah.
Right. So they build another layer above you before the last mile exists.
This is the same.
There's one more party sharing the, you know. So essentially, you know,
this
is
one.
The SIs could be sharing. Telcos may not want to, you know, or for that matter, telcos could be still more technically and, you know,
see,
advanced.
You know, the
market might not be, you know, willing to do all of this and they say, okay, SIs will do it for us.
Absolutely, good point. SIs will actually, you know, cater to primarily the enterprises, taking care of their needs of, you know, arbitrage and stuff like that. They've been doing that forever, right? Managed services. The Wipro will actually go into a General Electric or any of the banks actually in the US and do this entire turnkey thing. Telcos actually on the flip side will reach out to SMEs because of their reach, the broadband reach and stuff like that. So actually the market is getting fragmented. Early days yet, I can't say how it will shape up. Telco, nothing will prevent a telco from actually having an enterprise sales team and actually reaching out to enterprises and, you know, bludgeoning the story. Period. I don't think actually anything can prevent that. But, you know, I think one thing is for sure, let's all agree to disagree, but then agree on one thing, that actually a disruption is happening. Okay, so how it will shape up, I think, you know, all of us actually have to really take a peek into the future, gaze at the crystal ball and see, you know, how it's done.
One question. You can explain, let's say, something like a Microsoft Exchange.
Yeah.
Which is available as a cloud
yeah,
service. And I understood the channel part, where you said somebody like Apple would deliver that service.
Yeah, yeah.
To our end customer.
Yeah.
Where does the IT part come in for Jamcracker? Because Microsoft already would have exposed the service
yeah, yeah,
enough for a telco to actually consume it directly.
Absolutely. The only difference is that, you are right, it's actually about that layer that I talked about and the four or five key values. Single sign-on, for example. Microsoft will actually, you know, provision only their product.
Mm-hmm.
They will not provide all the services which is consumed by the SME. Service level agreement. Maybe Microsoft guarantees it, but there could actually be a smaller player who may not be able to give that level of guarantees or underwrite the code or escrow the code. Okay, so that's actually the second thing. The third element is actually in terms of, you know, scalability assurance. If actually, you know, Jampranker is, you know, signing up an agreement with an Infosys, and if the scalability actually has to, you know, if I have to build a scale for 1,000 users, a small time ISP will collapse. Whereas actually in collaboration with Jampranker, you will have the wherewithal to scale up to the requirement. This happened to us. We learned it the hard way. We actually had, you know, Aircom in Ireland, actually, you know, where they had it on the catalog for about 6 months, a service that was actually, you know, basically a marketing automation tool, which was actually evolved by a Baroda-based ISP, small-time ISP. No one expected that actually, you know, it will go through a hockey stick growth within 1 month. Suddenly, you know, it got viral because some smart sales guy actually went and pitched it to associations, and it's a herd mentality that followed. From actually, you know, 5 licenses, it jumped up to 700 licenses actually, or 700 instances in one go. And that was something that ISP couldn't handle. While we actually, you know, hosted it separately and provided the multi-tenancy capability that actually, you know, made it possible for the sales guy to leverage that. And the customer doesn't even know actually, you know, it's an ISP located in Baroda or wherever it is. They all know that they're consuming the service from Aircom. They call Aircom support line actually, you know, for getting service.
And Aircom sits in where
they? Yeah. Okay. And Jampranker actually handles level 2 and level 3 support. Tomorrow, if the ISP actually shuts shop for whatever reasons, Jampranker's responsibility to actually, you know, continue the service till such time you find a replacement for that. Okay? All of this actually, and then the onboarding itself. If I have to actually onboard a new service, this is a complex procedure. That's a topic for another discussion today, but I just want to share it in a nutshell that there are actually something like about 27 steps that are involved in the handshake of protocol between the service vendor and Jampranker to make SSO possible. Now, not everybody will have the ability, wherewithal, and technology to onboard the service. Answers your question? Okay? Doubts?
No.
Any questions?
Otherwise, you'll get it on.
No, we can actually.
Time to
why don't we do one thing? You know, I can actually, you know, leave my mail ID behind. I'd love to actually answer your questions because it's something that I all the while keep doing. But one of the things is actually any cloud session can go on for about, you know, 8 hours at a stretch, you know. So. Well, actually, I need to get back at 6 o'clock, but the thing is, you know, let's try to actually, you know, see whatever possible from the point of view of answering. Take a 30,000 feet perspective today. Let's actually, you know, define the scope of our discussion. Then it's easier. If you actually have to get into minus one level of, you know, no problem. I'm happy to answer the questions. But, you know, we might actually, you know, end up not achieving the objective today. Okay. Does this ecosystem, if you understood this, you understand cloud service brokerage model in full. Okay, I'd like to actually, you know, share with you how exactly is the market getting disrupted? Who is actually going to deliver all of these services going ahead in the future? So this is something that I want to actually share with you on next slide. As a cloud service broker, Jampranker is enabling it. What is in it for these three stakeholders? We agreed that actually the market is opened up for a telco. 2 years ago, a telco wouldn't even dream of selling an IT service because it's not their core competency. They were happy selling broadband, they're actually happy selling value-added services around voice and data, and that's it. Today, they find that they're in a very, very advantageous position because they carry the last mile into the customer. The broadband itself is actually a very powerful last mile and stickiness to the customer, right? So, for them, it's actually reducing customer churn. Very interesting thing over here. The US will go out actually the largest cable company. You know who it is, right?
Comcast.
Time Warner actually realized that, you know, I mean, it's an interesting development, we didn't know about it. They started offering up the services and they packaged it. They packaged it in such a way, they said that, you know, anyone who buys actually a broadband connection will get, you know, three services packaged along with that. I mean, it's bundling, right? And they're actually the ustads of bundling. Telcos actually have to bundle things very, very well, right? Data plans, you know, whatever, they actually bundled it very well. They bundled it. Surprise, surprise, they realized after actually 6 months that whoever actually bought the bundle are actually, you know, 5 times more prone to stay with the service provider. It's a very high churn market. Broadband, 3 months is here, the new offer comes up, the customer shifts over there and all that. But people who bought the services actually continue to be there. So they said, yeah, here's our secret sauce to actually hold customers. Because telcos grapple with one of the biggest topics in boardrooms of telcos is how do we retain our customers? How do we prevent the churn from happening? That's actually how they did it. They actually said, you know, the bundling services along, and they offer extremely attractive offers in terms of actually, you know, the service costing and pricing and all that. So they actually realized that they can, you know, reduce the customer churn by actually bundling in services. They were driving new businesses, and increase in profitability, because the margins actually in commodity business like broadband and other is so low they can't actually, you know, survive. So they are now actually, you know, looking at, you know, a kind of compensating that with these. For a distributor, like a traditional distributor like an Ingram Micro and all that, you can enable the value-added resellers, you can sell more services and increase profitability. In one go, now look at actually, you know, the advantage. Telco has the advantage of last mile. A distributor has the advantage of 14,000, 15,000, 20,000 resellers actually, you know, taking with them. So if they want to actually, you know, roll out a service, instantly it can be in the market. And that's actually, you know, what is driving the likes of Ingram Micro and all that to look at the cloud service growth earlier. An enterprise IT leader, answer some of your questions. They can leverage the cloud model for cost arbitrage. They can also actually centralize the delivery. I shared this, you know, they can work on a shared services across the enterprise, irrespective of the number of locations across the globe, and drive IT coherence. We realized that the cloud model could actually, you know, enforce IT policies in a very big way. Gone are the days where you actually have disparate systems actually canceling out, you know, productivity. You have one version of the application across the company. You can drive an IT policy, a stringent IT policy across the company. I mean, you've been a CIO, right? IT manager, right? So you understand it's tough, isn't it?
Yeah.
How do you enforce an IT policy? It's tough password policies and all that. People actually, you know, find a way around, right? So these are things that actually, you know, the cloud service provider model enhances. Questions yet? So let me actually just show them that, you know, the E-Suite. Live application, you know, you can Google for this and check it out. Look for E-Suite. E standing for Telstra. Telstra, the entire eco is actually powered by Jamrackers. So this is live. This is the production, okay? Now, if I actually go in over here, am I dropping it off? Someone is coming in, and in fact, I actually, you know, asked Ravi to, you know, Google and bring it up. So I'll just actually, you know, start off from the beginning. You see something called E-Suite applications. Click on this link here. So
So Jamfrontr provides the storefront infrastructure.
The marketplace and the storefront. We do that thing. And it's all in the back end. It's all powered by Jamfrontr, and that's it. You know, Telstra actually does the front end thing and we do the back end. Okay? So this is actually one of them. Now this is Telstra, really behemoth and very large. Let's look at a smaller player now. And I can buy it right here. I mean, actually, you know, I don't have to go through any rigmarole. If I know what to buy, I can just buy it. If I don't know what to buy, I can actually register for a trial and one of the sales
guys. You don't need to be a customer of for Telstra to buy this product.
Absolutely. You don't need to be a customer of Telstra. You need to have just a pipe. Internet.
Yeah, any
pipe. Yeah. There's a smaller reseller in the US. Live again. It's called greenapps.com. And he says, he's actually, you know, very specific. He's got only 5 services. Not for him, 40, 50 different services. I want to buy Microsoft Exchange Mail. I say order now, here. And seamlessly, it transfers into the web store or the shop front. I just actually add to cart over here. These are the flavors, 6GB, 4GB, 2GB, 1GB, whatever I want. I just say add to cart over here. That's it. From the website to the shop front, seamless. I punch in the money, payment gateway is integrated. It takes the details of your credit card and all that. And you get a mail confirming that your service is actually being provisioned for you. You'll get a password via mail. And as simple as net banking, you can actually start using the service within 24 hours time. A complex or something like that. Is it okay? Fine. That's great. So how do you actually prevent anyone from coming over there? It's like, yeah, no, we've got security guards and all that. And I said, I'm talking about something bigger. You know, there's a terrorist attack or actually something happens, earthquake happens and all that. This is not a question at all. Come on, no one can prevent that. That's an act of God. I said, if the act of God is actually known, and I can provide you with a 3-level fallback, which means I'll host my data center actually in a bunker which is 40 feet underground, in a fortress kind of environment. I've got a retina scan, actually, you know, for access into the physical access into the data center, and I'll actually host this in 3 continents. It's improbable that, you know, 3 continents will be actually struck by a natural calamity at the same time. And you'll get connected and up and running within 1 hour after something actually happens from your employees' houses. Is that actually an argument that you'll buy? They said, yeah, I think that's worth considering. Actually, that's where the argument lies. You're talking about here, and just actually to extend that academic discussion, I said, you know, what's the uptime you had? Now, never ask a CIO what is the uptime within his office. You know, they become very, very, you know, kind of guarded about it. You know, they say, you know, there were actually one or two instances. Every CIO will say, you know, ek do bare instances hai ki actually fail your quota or something like that. They actually don't give it to you, and you ask them percentages, they'll not say. Actually, in reality, most enterprises have an uptime of about, you know, 98%, 97-98%, and actually the CIOs get awarded for it. In public fora, they get awarded for actually that kind of uptime, system availability as it's called. Actually, every cloud provider has an uptime of 99.59. The service availability ratios have dramatically changed. The metrics are now 99.59. If you are anything lesser, or if you are lesser than 99.9, you are not a true SaaS vendor. That's what the statement is. Okay, so that's all. I mean, actually, there's no further argument on this. It's over. It's clear. That's actually how the whole thing works. So you are talking about uptime availability. We call it actually, you know, since I'm a marketer, I package it. I say enterprise availability at SMB price points. $5 mailbox, and you get 99.99% uptime availability. Mind blown. You can't actually, you know, match that even in enterprise. That answers one of the questions over there. Security also gets answered over there. There's a question about latency. What do you mean by latency? I mean, you said latency actually is a question, right?
Yeah, I mean, suppose you have one particular server which is located in, say, US.
Yeah.
And then you are accessing a particular software from India.
Yeah.
Typically, in your real time, what we see is there is latency. Whatever you type in, there is a delay from what you see on the screen and what you type in.
Yeah, yeah.
So, do you think that would be a difficult proposition when you try to sell
now? Yeah, I mean, I would actually, you know, set up a server in an India data center. Same service actually hosted in an India data center because hosting has become a commodity now. That's how we kill latency. Okay, so, but that's a very good question. Latency actually as a problem was existing earlier because hosting was actually a big ticket business. Today hosting is commoditized. So So all that we do is, you know, for example, in Europe, they actually, you know, insist for regulatory requirements that the server has to be hosted in the EU, European Union. So that's actually the way it works. So if you're in Europe, and if you're a business in Europe, you need to have a server hosted in Europe anyways. So same is the case actually for here. So most of the tools actually in Asia Pack actually hosted in Singapore or in Bombay or in Dalian or Beijing or whatever for their data centers. So it's not a problem anymore. You replicate the entire same thing over here. The only point is, you know, you are automatically built in a failsafe or a fallback mechanism also if any of the data center actually, you know, collapses. So you are replicating a mirror environment. Okay?
One question.
Yeah, sorry.
Apparently, the role of the service broker, can you say, is this the electronic distribution?
That's true.
Right?
Yeah.
So, is that one of the primary roles that you see
emerging?
Or is it only specific to this particular delivery of service?
Well, actually, if you want to, in the future, actually, pizzas could be ordered to the service broker. That's your question. I mean, that will actually change a lot of things. Hardware ordering and all of that. Offline delivery, but ordering could actually be online through the cloud service broker model.
Yeah, because in certain kind of delivery systems,
we
need to customize this for the client. Who plays the role? Is that the broker again?
No, that's not the broker. That's a very good question. The system integrator or the last mile partner will do that role. Could be a reseller. But are you familiar with the concept called crowdsourcing?
Yes.
You all know what's crowdsourcing? Offer up an application and invite people from the net to come and actually bid for that particular service. That's crowdsourcing, right? Crowdsourcing will actually be a big emerging opportunity for developers, freelance developers, who will actually, you know, bid for jobs for enterprises, do it offline or, you know, wherever with online tools, and deliver it and collect their payment online. So that is actually a new emerging opportunity. Okay. And what's the tipping point? Really, I think the tipping point ratio is actually changing, you know, that was your question, right? So, if you ask me this question about, you know, 2 years ago, the tipping point was 2,000 users. The tipping point today is 20,000 users, because the SaaS price points are actually also dropping down dramatically. 6GB mailbox used to retail for about $15. Today, it's actually, you know, retailing for $7. And there's a tier structure also. You buy 100 mailboxes, that's the price point. You know, 101 to 500, that's the price point. Anything above, you know, 500 to actually get this price point. Yeah, it actually, you know, makes the tipping point, you know, difficult. And besides the commercials, there's also actually other advantages of the cloud model. The advantages obviously being things like, you know, concurrency, the same version everywhere, scalability, one version of truth and all that. So that's the reason why on-premise development itself is actually coming down. So Microsoft Exchange, in its new avatar, will only be a cloud model, there will not be an on-premise model. So vendors themselves actually, you know, will exit that space. Okay. I think actually, you know, this is just a peek into the exciting world of cloud service brokerage. We had an interactive session. I'm sure there are actually a lot of questions. I just opened up your windows in terms of, you know, what the opportunity is. Let me do one thing. So Ravi had actually sent out, you know, a synopsis of stuff, okay, of what I covered, okay? Along with a few white papers and all that. Wide subject, but let me actually, you know, throw some light into that area. Feel free to actually, you know, send a mail to me. Okay, it's very easy to remember. It's lux@jamcracker.com. lux@jamcracker.com. Send a mail and I will be happy to actually answer your question. 24 hours turnaround. Unintended. I was meaning it actually, 24 hours
turnaround. It's not very operational. The size of the pipe in terms of network will drive how successful whole thing is, because everything will be on the pipe.
You're right.
Are we going to hit a roof? Are we really ready for this sort of traffic on the pipe, or, you know, that's a huge bottleneck.
Yeah.
If the network is not capable, then you can talk about 54% CAGR for first 5 years,
yeah,
and then just hits a roof.
Yes. I think, you know, see, there's a question that actually, you know, is a big policy question, particularly in India. And I've seen this question actually being thrown to the IT secretaries and stuff like that, you know, in the forum where, you know, you have government participation as well. This is a bigger problem in India than anywhere else, okay? Well, actually, you know, in the US and all that, for instance, you know, when you have streaming video, you know, you're familiar with Netflix, right? You can actually see streaming video online, and actually, there isn't even a hiccup, actually, you know, when it came to the video. So I don't think, actually, you know, it's really a problem elsewhere. Even China actually has got a very, very high quality of internet stuff. Broadband. So connectivity, I think, actually, you know, is one of the key underlying factors. It might be a choke, But what's actually also happening is, you know, if I look at historically, the rate of change of internet availability in India also actually has been meteoric. It's actually, you know, followed an inorganic growth path, and that's the reason why it continues to do so. So while actually the prices have been coming down, the availability of bandwidth has actually been scaling up, enormously. So everybody actually, you know, is wary of that, but it seems to me that actually, you know, this is probably maybe a theoretical worry, if I'm not actually sounding rude, because this worry actually is something that, you know, is keeping a whole lot of people going, and there's money in it. There's actually some commercials also here. I was talking to actually, you know, Hathaway Internet, right? These guys actually, you know, offer internet services, and I was actually, you know, really upset about, you know, the number of times they're going down and all that. The guy says 500 rupees per month, I'm giving you a 1 GB pack, okay? Now actually that is probably one of the lowest in the world, okay? I can actually ramp it up, you know, if I have high quality value consumers coming in. So I think these things will really be fine. India actually, you know, why do you think actually the voice quality on cell phones have been dropping? That's because investments are not in place to take care of the, you know, burgeoning growth in the connections. That's the reason why actually quality is being going down. You have a choke all the time. Technically, you know what's the reason why the call drops? Because there's a choke. It's pretty much similar to a traffic jam. So I think actually, you know, this is one problem that will be there. But I guess actually, you know, the rate of growth or proliferation of internet and availability of internet historically actually should, you know, take away our fears of whether it will be able to take it to the service. Pretty much the same way it actually has happened in the US, Japan, Australia, and China. China is actually, you know, the antithesis of this whole thing is China, which actually has got fantastic internet, but they don't consume as many cloud services for the simple reason that except localized content, you know, internationally available content has to be converted into text and actually not videos. So that's the reason why it's not so popular actually. There are cloud services, you know, there are also actually marquee companies there, but then it's not actually as pervasive as it is actually in Australia or Singapore or India. Okay. Thanks a lot. Thanks for your time. And do let me know if actually, you know, there's anything at all that I can actually answer. Thank you.
Thank you. Thanks, Shavi. The session was very informational. I have enjoyed getting into
I don't know about that. Maybe you can actually take feedback from that.
So, on behalf of IMD.
As you've seen, I enjoy interacting with the class because I always realize that, you know, interacting in a class environment actually brings up actually, you know, the best of questions and the most complicated ones, and that's why I was trying to be evasive for some of the questions, if you noticed. No, but seriously, I think I enjoy actually asking questions. Please drop a line and I'll send the synopsis across to you with some white papers and all that. Rakesh, depend on you to actually send it. Thanks a lot.
Thank you.